Good afternoon. Would you guys stand together with me and sing these words of God's amazing grace? Let's lift our hearts together. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. All right, sing it loud. Come on. T'was grace. T'was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear. One more time.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now was blind, but now I see.
Father, we thank you that we can come together in this place and sing of your amazing grace, and to celebrate life, to celebrate a legacy, and Lord, to remember the impact that Frank had on all of our lives and in this community. Lord, I pray that you would enlighten us this afternoon, that we would just have our hearts fixed on you, and that if there's anything that we've carried in here that's distracting us, that we would be set free of that right now in the name of Jesus. That we would be able to hear your words, that we would be able to just enjoy hearing stories and remembering together. So we love you. We thank you for this time we can be together. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, many of you may be wondering, who are these guys standing up here? We are the Ambassadors Quartet. And actually, Rick Pendergrass is here from Michigan. He used to sing the part that I'm singing. And Frank and Alan, my gosh, you guys sang out of high school, right? A long time ago. And we've been singing as a quartet for a lot of years, and we've gone through several changes through that time, but most recently it's been me, Alan, and Frank was singing baritone, which Rick is going to sing today. We were asked to sing a couple songs in memory of Frank, and it's really, really our honor to be able to carry on this legacy. The Ambassadors Quartet is going, we've talked a lot, and we really want to continue the legacy, so we're going to continue to sing as the Ambassadors Quartet, and we'll strive to be as excellent as Frank always wanted to be. I can remember many times sitting in front of the speakers and stuff. We'd sit in our practice room and we'd go over a song five or six times and say, let's do it again. I'm like, again? You know, but he always wanted to do it till it was perfect. And that's everything he did about his life. He made me a better person. And I'm very, very thankful and grateful to know Frank Woods. Thank you guys for letting us sing.
Is my heart's own home, though I never really had one to call my own. But I've been given the key by the carpenter of Galilee, with interest paid. The title's made to me. Home, where there is no night. Home, where the sun is the light. A place I've been dreaming of so long. But his sweet face will be the first I'll see when my journey's over. I am going home. Everybody dreams of going home, it seems. I am no exception to the rule. But home is so much more than windows, walls, and doors. It's a warm embrace with a smiling face to welcome. Home, where there is no night. Home, where the sun is the light. A place I've been dreaming of so long. Loved ones stand to welcome me, but his sweet face will be the first I'll see. When my journey's over, I am going home. Home, where there is no night. Home, where the sun is the light. The place I've been dreaming of so long. Loved ones now.
touch of hands so kind and tender.
Good afternoon, and thank you for being here. My name is Mike Fleischman. I'm the pastor here at Bethany Bible Church. And on behalf of the family and on behalf of our church, thank you for being here to be a part of this celebration. In some way, Frank touched every single life that is in this room right now and many, many more. And for that reason, we have great reason to celebrate and to remember, to laugh, to shed a tear at the loss, and to give glory and honor to God. So that's what we're going to do today. Today, we're going to remember and celebrate an amazing life. And I'm going to guess that in doing that, we're going to laugh some, because there's so much to remember that brought joy. And I wouldn't be surprised at different times along the way, a tear or two will be shed. And how could it not, in light of what a tremendous loss we've experienced? I only knew Frank in passing, but I know his legacy because I can see it, and I can see it in the lives that he touched. And it is immense, and it will endure, and it is much to give thanks for. I'm not often in the habit of quoting from the Apocrypha, just not part of my wheelhouse, but I would like to today. There was a Jewish scribe 200 years before Jesus, and his name was Sirach, and he wrote a collection that's called Ecclesiasticus. And he wrote this: "When a father dies, he will not seem to be dead, for he has left behind one like himself, whom on life he looked upon with joy, and at death without grief. He left behind him as an avenger against his enemies." Let's skip. "And one to repay the kindness of his friends." He has left behind a legacy, and I can see that today. God's greatest promises of hope and faithfulness are always seen against the backdrop of sorrow and darkness, always. So this is an opportunity today to see God's faithfulness and his goodness in a fresh new way. The Bible proves this. The book of Lamentations, darkest book in the Bible. It's a book about sorrow and loss and tears, and it's gloomy, but right in the middle, it says, "Surely my soul remembers and is bowed down within me. But then I recall this to mind, and I have hope. The Lord's loving kindnesses indeed never cease, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I have hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the person who seeks him. It is good that he waits silently for the salvation of the Lord." So if there's any gloom in this day, if there's any darkness, if there's any sorrow, I want to remind you, this is a day to see the fresh promises of God in brilliance like never before. His faithfulness, his goodness is new every morning. It was true today, and it will be true again tomorrow. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your promises that never fail. We thank you for your character that never changes. You are good from one generation to the next. Lord, I pray today as we're gathered together, this would be a time of celebration and joy, remembering, reflecting on our own lives. But God, I pray that you would be glorified, your Son Jesus Christ would be seen, and that your Holy Spirit would be evident in our midst, that in all things the name of your Son Jesus Christ might be known, magnified, and glorified from this place into the very ends of the earth. Bless those who are here today. I pray that your comfort, joy, hope, and revelation would be present in their life. In the name of Jesus we ask, amen.
Thank you, Pastor. My name is Marlene Collins. I've known Frank through many of those hairstyles, as I'm sure everyone in this room has. But I think our friendship started, what, about 40 years ago when Frank and Barb and Steve were so involved with cystic fibrosis, and we had a lot of fun sharing some fundraisers and so many other things. So, honored to be here today to present the eulogy. His story began on Tuesday. His story began on Tuesday, December 14th, 1943. Franklin Ben Woods was born in Webster City, Iowa. It was a Mayberry-like town of about 6,000 or 7,000 people, and I don't think much bigger today, actually. His dad, Frank, pastored a very small Baptist church there, and his mother, Stella, was a stay-at-home mom who had mastered the responsibilities that are required of one who's helping to oversee the flock of a church membership. Frank's only sibling was Lenora, and she was 17 at the time he was born. His childhood memories were rich and varied, and he had a very good memory, Barbara has shared. At the young age of 3, Frank witnessed the heartbreak of seeing his dad's church burn to the ground. Can you even imagine what that would be? It was a nightmarish scene that stayed with him for the rest of his life. He remembered that very vividly. But he also flourished under the umbrella of cherished memories only small towns can really afford to young people and make the kind of impressions that they do on a young life. He took great pride in his mother's flower gardens and vegetable gardens, and he loved hunting and fishing with his dad, and shoveling the walkway was one of his chores, and it probably wasn't his most favorite, but as always, he found good in everything and took a sense of pride in a job well done, and he did that often. He was grateful for the work ethic that his parents instilled in him, that he carried with him throughout his life, and I know he considered those very special gifts from them. The entrepreneur bug hit him when he was about 5th grade, and he started a newspaper route. And then, about a year later, he figured that he could really increase his bottom line if he started mowing lawns. So he did that, and in very short order, he was able to buy the first bicycle he ever owned, and he, of course, took great pride in that. As one would expect, the grade school was small in Frank's rural community, and he was one of 8 students in his 8th grade class. He then moved on to Webster City High School, and he stayed and was there through his sophomore year, at which time his dad announced that he was going to retire from the pulpit and move the family west to a place called Phoenix. So it was a very natural transition for Frank because he loved music, and music can follow you anywhere, and haven't we had amazing music this morning or this afternoon? Thank you, everyone. He made that transition beautifully and began his junior year at Phoenix Christian High School, his beloved alma mater that he continues to support even today. His passion for music led to a memorable band and choir trips, a lot of band and choir trips. It also led to a victory in a music competition as a member of the Seniors 4 Quartet. After graduation, as we heard earlier, these guys stayed together, and the young singing group became the Ambassadors Quartet. And as you mentioned, there were some interchanges throughout, but for the most part, they were together singing throughout the Southwest for 60 years. Can you even imagine that? They opened once for the Oak Ridge Boys. And Barb said right up until Frank became ill in November, he was tweeting twice daily to Joe Bonzel from, Joe is one of the Oak Ridge guys, and he was tweeting a couple of times a day with him. His last opportunity to sing with the group was on November 14th, just a couple of weeks before he passed away. But let me go back to those days at Phoenix Christian because they're really rich. His whole life was rich, okay. With his love for music and his passion for excellence, by the time he was approaching high school graduation, he had decided to pursue a career as a music teacher. And knowing the limited means of his parents, he knew it would be up to him to find his college education. Now, he had taken an industrial arts class on printing at Phoenix Christian, and he learned enough about the graphic arts industry to get him his first job, and that was at Allied Printing. This would enable him to earn the money he needed in order to get that teaching degree. Now, just about this time, God was multitasking, as we all know he has a tendency to do, and also at work in South Carolina at the ultra-conservative Bob Jones Academy. Barbara Staggs was a Phoenician whose father pastored the Freeway Baptist Church here in town. And she had been sent to Bob Jones Academy for her junior and senior years because her parents felt that Phoenix Christian was too liberal. And they wanted to be certain that their daughter was not headed for the wild side. So Barbara had exited Phoenix Christian following her sophomore year, and she was headed into her junior year. She went to her junior year at Bob Jones, and then she was entering her senior year back on the East Coast when Frank was arriving in Phoenix at Phoenix Christian. So if you followed that. So there their paths had really not crossed yet. Both of these preachers' kids had lived under very similar rules. No dating, no dancing, no movies. In short, a very, very conservative upbringing. So it was the old revolving door theory. Barb had left Phoenix. She was back on the West Coast. Frank came to the East Coast. Frank came to the West Coast. And so for her senior year in the East, his here, little could they have known that God was already at play in their lives. The summer following Frank's junior year at Phoenix Christian coincided with Barb graduating from Bob Jones Academy. And it was a chance meeting at the water fountain when she got back home at her dad's church, August 23rd, 1961. She and Frank showed up at the same time at the same water fountain. And Frank would later love to tell people that he met his wife at a water fountain and, quote, she gave him a drink. That stuck with him his whole year. So 3 days later, on August 26th, they had their first date to a Truth for Youth rally at the Encano Park Bandshell. I don't know if many of you would remember how popular the Bandshell was back in the 60s, but that was the place, that was a really popular venue. After the rally, they went, of course, to Bob's Big Boy at 19th Avenue and Bethany Home Road, had a Bob's Big Boy and a milkshake, and ever forget the big statue of Bob standing outside his restaurant. Well, after that first date, their life together really began. And Frank and Barb never dated anyone else. And by October 23rd, they were going steady. So Barb remembers Frank's senior year because she was here and she was able to follow the band and the teams and whatever, and could listen to Frank play at the games, and they continued to attend their Truth for Youth rallies, but they never went to a movie, at least not until after they were married. And after they were married, they went to their first movie. It was at the Cine Capri, and they were both wondering if they were going to be struck by lightning. So they were married on April 19th, 1963, less than a year after Frank had graduated from Phoenix Christian. And they vowed that day to keep God at the center of their marriage, and they certainly did. One of the countless examples of their service to him through their married life and before, at two different points in their marriage, Frank and Barb had handled music at two different churches, and he was the choir director, and she would play keyboard. They had some interesting conversations when they were going through all that, Barb shared. Somewhere along the way, Frank realized that he couldn't make the kind of living for which he aspired as a music teacher. So fortunately, he had fallen in love with the craft of printing. And he never lost his love for music or for teaching. And by the late 60s, he had launched not only a printing company, but a recording studio, and he put them side by side in a small industrial center in central Phoenix. And he called the venture AMBET, and that was short for Ambassadors Enterprises. So in the early 70s, the printing firm merged with several other graphic arts companies, and Frank became the vice president of sales for Associated Lithographics. He was learning all aspects of the printing business, but never forgot the role of the mentors in his life. Carsten Solheim hired Frank in the 70s in order to establish an in-house printing division at Carsten Manufacturing. It was a very short stint that culminated when Frank went to Carsten and suggested that he would be a much better vendor than employee. Carsten agreed, and Carsten Manufacturing became the founding client of Woods Lithographics, and the rest is history. Under Frank's leadership, Woods Litho became known as the premier printer for corporations and advertising agencies, not just throughout the Valley, but around the country. As his client list grew, so did the list of awards, achievements, and exceptional printed pieces, clearly setting standards all over the country. Frank was personally responsible for the development of and the proprietary introduction of the UltraDot printing system, which received national acclaim, creating a new benchmark of excellence in the industry. On May 19th, 1965, Barb and Frank had welcomed Steve, their only child into the world. And Frank and Steve enjoyed an enviable father and son relationship. And they spent a lifetime of making lasting memories. Whether they were working, traveling, shooting pool, eating tacos, or fishing, whatever they were doing, the big part was they were doing it together. And most importantly, in addition to sharing all those memories, they share the Lord. The Woods were a God-loving, church-loving family. And family really was everything to Frank. He and Barb were married 58 years. They were thrilled when Steve married Teresa Vandenberg in 1984, and 4 years later presented them with their first of three absolutely beautiful granddaughters. Brittany is now married to Doug Whitney, and she is an interior designer at Ethan Galleries, Ethan Allen in Scottsdale. Ashley is now Mrs. J.T. Henderson and is a resident life manager at Grand Canyon University. And Samantha is a senior at Wheaton College. All three women have brought such pride and joy to Frank and Barbara. And as if the granddaughters weren't enough, Frank was completely overjoyed to welcome three great-grandchildren from Brittany and Doug. Today, with the rest of the family, of course, Faith, beautiful Faith, who is eight, handsome Hudson, who is five, and his namesake, I'm sure sound asleep at being the perfect child, Hunter Franklin, who has just turned 10 weeks old. It has always been obvious to all of us in the Woods world that his love of family and God, giving back to community, and excellence in all he endeavored were the hallmarks of Frank's life. In addition to being an amazing husband and father and friend, Frank was a prominent, respected businessman in the Phoenix printing industry and throughout the nation for more than 50 years. He gave back generously to his community, helping innumerable nonprofit organizations leave a lasting impression through their collateral material. The program today is just one example of, you know, the impressions that they've made to thousands through the years. Among his countless honors, he was a member of the esteemed Ben Franklin Honor Society, and he was inducted into the very prestigious Distinguished Printing Hall of Fame in 1996. In the booklet we've received today, and please be sure to fill out that perforated thing and turn it in, because that's really special. In the booklet you received, you have the wonderful summary of Frank's professional career, which was written by Frank, that was included in the Book of Wisdom that was published by the Ben Franklin Honor Society. I encourage you to read not only his story, but his valued advice on life. In recent years, Frank turned to consulting and loved working with a host of clients, none more than Jack and Patty Ball, who became an important part of this chapter of his career. His relationship with them and their business constituted a very, very important part of his life. We all know that Frank was an exceptional human being. He gave freely and generously, asking nothing in return except goodness and friendship. We're here today to honor and celebrate his love for life, for family, for his faith, his music, and his profession. One of my favorite adages comes to mind today. God always gives his best to those who leave the choice, in Frank's case, choices, to him. God richly rewarded Frank for those choices, and today for certain, he is proclaimed, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." No doubt, Frank is leading the choir today. He truly loved the words of music of Donnie Rambo's, "I'm Gonna Leave Here Shouting," and it was the song he always soloed with the Ambassadors Quartet. Were he with us in person, this surely would be his close. So I'm going to leave you with the words of the closing stanza. If I can get through it. Okay, this again would be the last stanza. Don't want nobody weeping when I draw my final breath. I'll fall asleep in the cradle of love and never feel the sting of death. So say a big hallelujah, because I finally reached my goal and I'm gonna leave here shouting when my time comes to go. Rest in peace, our sweet friend.
My name is Jeffrey Canton, and Last week, Steve reached out to me and asked me if I'd be willing to share a few words, a few stories that I had with Frank over the past number of years, and I said absolutely. He also said, we need you to fill about 6 to 8 minutes. And I thought, with the press room antics alone, I could speak for 6 to 8 days. So I'll do my best. But first and foremost, from the Canton family to the Woods family, we offer our condolences. We love you guys. We all know Frank's faith, rock solid. We know where he's at. We know that God called him to do bigger and better things right now, but it doesn't change the fact that we're all hurting a little bit. So I just hope today that what you see and what you hear helps fill that void just a little bit. So I met Frank in 1979. I was 9 years old. He began to sell to my father. My dad is Bob Canton. He was the media and print buyer for Carson Manufacturing Corporation at that time. He was new, and Frank and my dad are a lot alike. So you can imagine those type of A-type personalities. They're always right, they're controlling, they're doers. The first meeting didn't go very well. In fact, Frank went home and told Barb, it's over, it's done. We're not gonna sell any more print to Ping, it's done. And being the genius salesperson that Frank was, he found a common thread with my father, which is hard to do. And it was the passion of fishing. So for the next number of years, they used that relationship to forge a relationship for the rest of their lives. And fortunately, Frank allowed me to be part of it. He asked my dad, why don't you invite your son? Because Steve was coming. So years later, Frank would regret that invitation because I was an obnoxious, hyperactive kid. And when you're that kind of person on a boat and you're kicking the tackle box and you're getting sunscreen all over his seats and you're talking and you're asking Frank to go to the bathroom and unhook your lure, it was a miserable experience for all of us. There was one story where we were fishing and it's 4 o'clock in the morning, it's dark, it's cold. Steve, Frank, and my dad are so excited to go fishing, I'm miserable. And Steve goes down to check on the boat and comes racing back and the door flies open and Steve says, the boat's gone. Someone stole the boat. And I was like, yes, no fishing. Unfortunately, we found the boat and we continued to fish. Another fishing trip, Frank brought another person to the group, and I think his name was Glenn, and he had his own boat. And Frank told me years later, the reason why he invited Glenn was because he had his own boat, so I could go on his boat and I wouldn't be on Frank's boat. But I was telling Steve that looking back at these stories gives us a different perspective of what Frank was trying to teach us, because he ultimately was a teacher. And as challenging as it was to have those experiences as a youth, Frank wanted me to have that experience with my father as Frank had with his son, Steve. And they forged that relationship in fishing outside of work to really love one another and spend time to one another. And Frank wanted me to have that experience with my father. And to this day, my dad is 81 years old and we still fish and he still outfishes me. So I'm very thankful that Frank invited me into your family to do that. So years later, I'm a young parent trying to support my family and didn't have any direction, wasn't sure what I wanted to do, but I knew I had to support my family. So Frank gave me a job. Frank gave me an opportunity to learn a trade that with hard work, I could support my family for the rest of our lives. And I'm so thankful for that. If Frank had not given me that first job, I would not be here today. I wouldn't have the family I have today. I wouldn't have the career that I've had, or the friendships and the experience I've had. So I'm very thankful. Now, I worked at Woods of the Graphics for 9 years and 11 months. 9 years and 11 months. And in those 9 years and 11 months, I had so many experiences. I was so blessed to be around so many incredibly gifted artists, professionals, and I'm so thankful. The experiences that I had, the lessons that I learned there, just made me the man that I am right now. With that time there, I saw a lot of things about Frank. Some of the things I saw was his intensity. And I think we all saw the intensity. And if you didn't see Frank's intensity, you could do what I would do. And that would use his personal bathroom and get caught using his personal bathroom. Now that, you would see the intensity of Frank Woods. Or, I heard someone talking about Frank's desk. Go behind his desk and rummage through all his papers trying to find your quotes as Frank comes in. Now that was some intensity. It was almost like a Roger Rabbit episode. His eyes were so far out of his head. The sales meetings. When I worked in sales, there was a lot of intensity there. It was when our sales were good, he was very appreciative and he told us how proud of us he was, but he made sure that we didn't get complacent. And when sales weren't doing well, he did a very good job of motivating us to get our butts out of the building and to get out and sell. So far that we would scurry up to our desks and I would pack up my stuff and grab my briefcase and I would think, where am I supposed to go? I have no clients to go to. And I would look over and I would see Jim Tratup sitting there reading his newspaper, not even fazed by what Frank just yelled at us. And he looked at me and said, you kids, Frank yells at you and you get scared. All you're gonna do is run off and hide at Denny's to make him think that you're selling printing. And I thought, Denny's, what a great idea. So Dave Crone's here somewhere. Dave, all his expense reports of my Denny's and First Watch, now you know what I was doing there. Patience, Frank was also very patient, at least with me. And some stories of his patience were, I was meeting with a client and the client was not thrilled to work with us. His boss made him buy our printing. He didn't like me, he didn't like our company, and he pretty much talked poorly of us for about a half an hour. And at one point I thought Frank was just gonna reach over and grab him by the neck and just pop his head off his body, but Frank was very reserved. We finished the meeting and Frank kind of wrapped everything up in that Frank way. And as we walked outside, Frank said to me, you have another client nearby? And I said, yes. And he said, let's go see your client. And I said, Frank, I just want to go back to the office and puke and cry because that was so miserable. And Frank reminded me, and we learned this in integrity selling, but he reminded me that when you're down, you got two options, stay down or get up. The only way to success is through failure. And we went to our next meeting and the client, Peter Canellis, he liked me, he loved Frank and loved the company, and it was a great meeting. And when we left that meeting, Frank said to me, had that meeting gone like the first one, we would have gone to another meeting because you can't stay down. Another example of Frank's patience, or I should say lack of patience, was as a young salesman who was obnoxious, talked too much, talked too fast, didn't listen. Frank knew that he wanted me to be successful. He knew he had no patience to deal with an idiot like me. So I get a phone call from Steve. Steve says, come into my office. I go into Steve's office and Steve says, from now on, Jeff, whenever you're gonna talk to my father, I want you to do a debrief with me. Whatever you're gonna say to my dad, you say to me, pretend that I'm Frank. And we did this for 3 or 4 months and it was painful. But that time with Steve and Frank's thoughtfulness to have Steve help me with that, made me learn how to be better with my communication, more prepared, and just get my thoughts in order and really value time. So I'm so thankful for that patience in Frank and Steve. Support, Frank was very supportive of me and my career and my family. Just a couple examples. When I was started out at Woods, I worked in the press room as a helper, and I had a starving family. And I went to Mike Sheldon and I said, Mike, I need more work. Anything you'll give me, I'll clean the floors, I'll clean the bathrooms, I'll work in the bindery, whatever you need, I will do whatever it takes. And Mike went to Frank and Frank said, give him the extra hours as long as he's on time and he works hard. And that really made me realize what hard work was. That at Woods of the Graphics, you could do very well if you worked very hard. And I'm so thankful for that because that additional finances really helped support our family. Another time Frank was so supportive of my career was when I got my first big opportunity with a client and we were doing a big presentation and I was working late in the conference room every night for probably 3 weeks, putting this thing together. And the last week that I was in preparing this presentation, every single night, Frank would come in there to the office. One night he had a Suns game, finished the Suns game, came back just to check on me. He would have dinner, he would come back to the office and just check on how the presentation was going. Probably just so I wouldn't screw it up. But he was there to offer support and give me wisdom and give me his input. And most importantly, he would say to me, if you need me, I'm in my office. And just the fact that here I'm some dumb young printer salesman and you've got a Hall of Fame printer that says, if you need me, I'm in my office. Just the fact that he said he was going to be there for me really meant a lot to myself. That client, we ended up getting the business. It changed my career. And to this day, I am still very close friends with all those people. So that was my work relationship with Frank. I'm going to have to read this one. I'm sorry. Once Frank and I were no longer employer and employee, we continued our friendship for the next 15 years. Over lunches, good wine, great whiskey. Our fondest memory was we would always have a Christmas lunch together at Capitol Grill at the Biltmore at Ken's table. And I so look forward to that. This year would have been our 15th year. As soon as I would sit down, he would say to me, "What's up with the beard? What's up with the hair?" He would call me a liberal Democrat. I'm not. But then he would ask me, "How's your family? How's your mom and dad?" And that really meant a lot. Always asked me about my family. We would share our life's experiences, how they've shaped us, how they've humbled us, how they've made us appreciate life, because as we all know, life goes too fast. Family was always the main topic. "Barb, he talks so highly of you. He would call you his rock, his anchor," and I think a good way in the anchor, the good way. "Stevie was so proud of you." He would talk to me about how proud he is of your work ethic, your commitment to go after your dreams just like him, how you and Teresa raised such an incredible family. When he would talk about the girls, Brittany, Ashley, and Samantha, his face would just light up. He was so proud of you, your accomplishments, and so excited about what God had in store for you. Frank was a teacher, so I was looking at a situation, what would Frank want me to learn from? I think in Frank's passing, Frank Woods, my mentor, would want me to remember what we discussed so many times at our lunches. Love on your family. Be disciplined because life gets in the way. Don't do tomorrow what you can do today. Everything is a lesson. Let your family and friends know how much you love them. And most importantly, spend time every day with your Father God.
Well, I want to thank everyone who has shared this far. It's been really insightful to learn that Phoenix Christian is too liberal, and that Bob Jones and whiskey are good. So thank you for sharing. Yeah. Very, very insightful. It's a great honor for me to provide some context for our time together today. I want to start by thanking Pastor Mike and the team here at Bethany for hosting us, including the Unger family and those who have come in to serve on what is perhaps a day off. I want to really thank Steve and Barbara for this honor. You are a beautiful legacy family and a treasure to the Valley, and we honor your family, and we honor his legacy and its continuation through the generations. Barbara, you are delightful. You are dear. I married a pastor's daughter, and those are always the first-round draft picks, so Frank was very honored to do life with you. You are a wonderful, dear woman, and very sweet. It's an honor to be here, and we're all here to love and support you and your family. We love you very much, and I want to thank all of you for joining us. We just celebrated during the Christmas season that Jesus Christ is God who came down to be with us. That's the ministry of presence. Jesus could have just spoken to us from heaven, but instead he came to join us on the earth. And when we get together, it's ministry of presence. It's being together, and it means a lot to the family. So on behalf of the family, thank you for your ministry of presence. As a Bible teacher, I have the honor of telling the big story of which Frank's life was part of that big story. And it's impossible for us to make sense of the story of our life until we first understand the big story of God. And the first time that I sat at an event like this, I was 10 years of age. My Grandpa George had passed. I love my Grandpa George with all my heart. He was my favorite person. He was a lot like Frank. He was extroverted, life of the party, fun, joyful, highly relational, absolutely good for his word, and as his grandson, I adored him. He was my favorite person. And my grandfather passed away. He was the first person I had lost. And I remember sitting in an event like this, and someone got up to do curiously what I am assigned to do, and that is to explain why my grandfather was gone. And I can still remember, as a young boy, they said that it was normal and natural and that death was just part of the cycle of life and that we needed to embrace it. And even as a 10-year-old boy, something in my soul was absolutely troubled and triggered. And I realized that I was angry, that this wasn't normal. I wasn't supposed to say goodbye to my grandfather, that the person that we all loved and enjoyed and appreciated so much shouldn't be absent. He should always be present. And I remember as a little boy being unable to process because I was so angry. It was some years later, I met a pastor's daughter, and she gave me a Bible, my now wife, Grace. And as I was reading it, I'll never forget, as a college freshman sitting in my dorm, reading in 1 Corinthians 15, where it says that death is an enemy. And that made sense. It's an enemy. It's an enemy that always wins. And we've spent a few years now, even globally, just fighting this enemy that we can never seem to defeat. We may delay death, but we never defeat death. And understanding death as enemy makes so much sense to me. And that frames for us what the Bible gives us as the understanding of how we got to this place today. If you are a Christian, let this be a reminder for you. The Bible has many occasions, particularly with the Apostle Paul, where he says, I want to remind you. And it's not something that you don't know, but it's just good to hear it again. Kind of like when you go home and your spouse tells you, I love you. You know it. It's just good to be reminded. For those of you who do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, this is a good way for you to frame the story of your life within the big story of God's Word. And the story of the Bible is that there is only one God, and that this God is without beginning or end. He is absolutely eternal. He is perfect and good, and He is the Creator. And He intentionally architected this planet as a gift for us to enjoy, and He created us in His image and likeness to enjoy this planet as a gift and to also enjoy a relationship with Him. This God is personal, He is relational, He is loving, He is the source of life, He is altogether good. And one of the first things we learn about Him in the Bible is that He likes to bless people because that's the kind of God that He is. And God made us perfect and placed us in a perfect environment and gave us a perfect relationship with Him. Now, He is independent and we are dependent. God can live without us, but we cannot live without God. And God commanded and instructed humanity that we were supposed to live dependent in relationship with Him. And what we sadly, tragically chose was to live independently of God. We severed that relationship. We walked away from the source of life. In the same way, a piece of technology that is no longer plugged in, it begins a deterioration process until eventually it runs out of power and it ceases to operate and function appropriately. So it is with us. We literally unplug from the source of life, the God who made us. This is what the Bible refers to as sin. It's rebellion, it's folly, it's self-destruction. And the result of that is death, because when we separate from the living God, we separate from the source of life. And this infected and affected all of God's creation and every human being in the history of the world. Now, God had two choices at this point. Number one, He could simply allow us to die without any hope, rescue, salvation, or opportunity. Number two, He could do something. And this is where Christianity is different than all other religions. Almost every other religion will tell you that there is a problem between us and God and that someone needs to create a solution, a rescue, and only Christianity says that God is the solution and the rescuer. Every other religion tells us what to do. Christianity tells us what Jesus Christ has done. And this problem of sin and subsequent death was something that God decided that He would, of His own accord, His love and His grace, that He would solve our problem and He would defeat this death. And so the Father sent His Son. And this had to be an incredible sacrifice. I mean, we just heard about a father who loves his son. Well, there is another father who had a son that he loved, and he sent him to suffer, and he sent him to serve. and he sent him to defeat death, and his name is Jesus Christ. We just celebrated his birth at Christmas, and we'll celebrate his resurrection at Easter. And so Jesus Christ enters into human history. And what's really curious about Jesus, he makes some astonishing, unprecedented, unparalleled claims in the history of the world. First and foremost, he says that he came down from heaven. No one says that. We all tell of our hometown. We heard today of where Frank was born and where Frank grew up and when Frank moved. And Jesus says that he came down from heaven. He says that that, in fact, is his home because he is eternal and creator God. In addition, Jesus says that he's perfect without any sin. He says that no one can prove him guilty of any sin of any sort or kind. He's the only person in the world who could make that claim without the crowd just literally erupting in laughter. Even non-Christians will say, quote, no one is perfect. Well, there is one exception. In addition, Jesus said that he was the only God. And this is an unprecedented, unparalleled claim in the history of the world. There is no major world religion that has its founder stating that he is God. Only Jesus makes that claim. And they sought to put him to death for declaring himself to be God. In addition, Jesus said that he would die for our sin as the substitute and savior, and that he would resurrect physically, bodily, victoriously from death, and that he would forgive sin and he would open heaven. He made this astonishing claim. And he, in fact, fulfilled every claim and promise that he uttered. Now, we are here in a Christian church. Christianity is now the largest movement of any sort or kind in the history of the world. To this day, more people are devoted to Jesus than anyone who has lived in human history. Billions today would claim to be Christians or followers of Christ. More songs are sung to him, more paintings are painted of him, more books are written regarding him than anyone who has lived in the history of the world. We celebrate time by the birth of Jesus Christ into B.C., before Christ, A.D., Anno Domini, the year of our Lord. The biggest holidays are Christmas and Easter, his birth and resurrection. And the point is simply this: if Jesus did not rise, then Christianity would not exist. The fact that we are here, the fact that this church is open, the fact that Frank knew and loved and trusted in 100% fully and completely, right until his final breath, the Lord Jesus Christ as his God and Savior, would have been completely impossible unless Jesus is exactly who he says he is and does exactly what he says he does. Jesus faced incredible opposition. He came from a small town, not a big city. His parents were likely teenagers. They were poor peasants. He lived in obscurity. His dad was a carpenter. No one saw from him or heard from him until he was around 30 years of age. He never held a political office. He never went to college. He never traveled more than a few hundred miles from his home. He never married a woman. He never fathered a child. He never penned a book. And today, his legacy is the biggest and the most significant and impactful and longstanding in the history of the world. The point is simply this: if Jesus Christ is dead, then so is the Christian faith. But because Jesus Christ is alive, so too we live with hope of our resurrection. And that's why we're here today. I'm telling you this: Frank loved Jesus. Frank knew Jesus. Frank trusted Jesus. And now Frank is with Jesus. I know we're having a bad day. He's having a very good day. This is a great day. This is where his faith becomes sight. This is where the Jesus that he loved is now the Jesus that he is with. And I'm sure that he misses you, but the good news is that there can be this incredible eternal reunion in the presence of Jesus and those who love him. And when it comes to Jesus, I just need you to know that you're going to need to trust someone for your life, for your decisions, and for your eternity. And I am begging you, I am imploring you, I am asking you to trust in Jesus Christ. He's the only one who has gone through death and come back to tell us what awaits us on the other side. There is no one else to trust. There is no one else to follow. There is no one else to absolutely, incontrovertibly, eternally be assured that if you follow him, you follow him into God's glorious kingdom and into the presence of God forever. You and I love Frank. The reason you're here is because you love him, but here's why you love Frank, because when you saw him, you saw Jesus in him. Whether or not you know Jesus, he did. And what you loved about him was Jesus through him. That Jesus Christ had such an intimate relationship with him that his character was reflected. that his love was emulated, that his compassion was extended through his son and his servant. And ultimately, there was a day when Jesus was in the same emotional state and event that we find ourselves in today. Jesus loved his family and he loved his friends, as Frank did. And he had one family that he was particularly close with. It was a brother named Lazarus and two sisters named Mary and Martha. And when Jesus was traveling, he would often go to their home and spend time together. They were like extended family. And then the news is given to Jesus that his dear friend Lazarus had passed away, had died. And so Jesus made the long journey, as some of you have, and thank you for making that journey. He made that journey to have the ministry of presence, to be with Mary, to be with Martha, to be with the family and the friends, to have a moment like this, to process and to grieve because the soul needs it. And one of the sisters approached Jesus, and they were very emotional. And if you're very emotional, that's okay. It's good to grieve. Ecclesiastes says that sometimes a sad face is good for the heart. That sometimes we need to look at death and we need to grieve as God does. And what happens in this moment, she is very emotional and she is weeping and she is grieving because she has lost this brother that she loves so dearly. And Jesus kindly speaks to her and he says this in John 11, I am the resurrection and the life. Many religions will tell you that there is a way. Jesus tells us that he is the only way. He says confidently, concretely, certainly, I am the resurrection and the life. That little phrase, I am, it is something that was originally uttered many years prior to a man named Moses. He was wandering in the wilderness. He did not know what God would have for his life. And God appeared to him. And he was uncertain who that God was. And so he asks, well, which God are you? And he says, I am. Jesus Christ showed up one day to Moses so that Moses could have a revelation of who God is. I'm telling you that today Jesus Christ is showing up to those of you who may not yet know him, and he is revealing himself to you as the only God. And he looks at her and he echoes that phrase from Moses and he says, I am the singular and exclusive resurrection and life. And there he's talking about eternal life. And let me tell you this, friends, eternal life does not begin the day you die. It begins the day you meet Jesus Christ. Frank had eternal life on this planet, and once he departed, he then walked into the fullness of his eternal life. But before you go into eternal life comes to you. It's this confident assurance. It's this lifting of a burden. It is this absolute certainty that your future will be okay because awaiting you on the other side of death is your Lord and Savior who has forgiven sin and conquered death, and his name is Jesus Christ. The Bible says that when we die, it has these curious phrases. It says to live is Christ and to die is gain. I need you to know that right now, the man that you're here to celebrate, he is experiencing gain. It says that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Right now, he is with the Lord Jesus Christ. Just as assuredly as we are here together in the presence of one another, Jesus Christ and Frank are together. That is such an encouragement. That is such a hope. It doesn't make our grieving any less, but it makes our hope that much more. The Bible also says that to depart and be with the Lord is, quote, far better. Far better. His day is far better than the best day that he previously had in this life. Well, Jesus goes on to say, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, it all comes down to you and Jesus. The most important decision you will ever make is whether you receive or you reject Jesus Christ as God and Savior. Do you believe in him? We're not talking here about religion or morality or spirituality. We're not talking about tradition. We're also not talking about the church. And I want to say this, that sometimes people struggle with Jesus because they've been hurt by the church. And let me say this, just like every family, we've got our pains, problems, and perils. But our Savior is perfect. And Jesus says, whoever believes in me, though he die. Let me say this, friend. The most important decision you will ever make is whether or not you believe in Jesus Christ, and the most important day of your life is the day that you die. The day that you die ushers you into the life that you will experience forever, that of condemnation or salvation, that of pain or pleasure, that of death or life, and it all comes down to your relationship with Jesus Christ. He goes on to say, and everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Never die. This is where when the Bible speaks of those who die but know the Lord, it uses a different phraseology. It says that they have fallen asleep. What it means is that their body goes into the ground, but their soul goes into the presence of God until one day Jesus Christ returns and he rejoins and resurrects the body and the soul. You and I, if we belong to Jesus, you need to know that this life is as close to hell as we ever get. And if you don't know Jesus Christ, I love you. And my hope is not to insult you, but to encourage you and to urge you. If you don't know Jesus, this life is as close to heaven as you will ever be. If you don't know Jesus, this is as good as it will get. And if you do know Jesus, this is as bad as it will be. And again, Jesus is emotionally present, and he's compassionate, and he's empathetic, but he's also pointing to the future because that's where our hope comes from. And then he asks this pregnant question. He looks at her, and I would look at you, and I would ask you the same question on behalf of the Lord Jesus. Do you believe this? That's his question. Do you believe this? Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life? That if you believe in him, though you die, you shall live. That he is the resurrection and the life. Do you believe this? You and I need to believe this, and I am telling you with utter confidence the reason that the family is grieving and mourning in a healthy way and why the friends who love Jesus and love Frank are grieving and mourning in a healthy way is because he believed this, and we do too. He concludes, the Lord Jesus does, by asking her this question, and she said to him, yes, Lord. And she is here pronouncing Jesus Christ as the highest authority in all of the cosmos and all of history. Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world. What's really amazing is that Jesus can comfort you where you are, just as he comforted her where she was. In addition, he can comfort Frank and those who die because he goes before them to forgive sin and defeat death. You and I now have this amazing opportunity to grieve, but to grieve in a way that has hope. We've spent a few years as a globe battling this ancient foe, this undefeated opponent of death. And it comes for us all. And some, we see it coming, and some, it comes very suddenly. And when it comes, for those of us who are left behind, God invites us to process and to grieve. The shortest verse in the whole Bible is that Jesus wept. It's okay to shed your tears, your Lord did. But when we grieve, if we know Jesus, we grieve with hope. I want to close with this scripture. It says in 1 Thessalonians 4, we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep. Again, the language of those who have passed but know the Lord Jesus. It's different than death. That you may not grieve as others who have no hope. What he's saying is grieve, but if you know the Lord Jesus, you grieve differently because in addition to the grief, you have hope beyond the grief. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. It says that Jesus goes before us, and if we follow him, we follow him through death and resurrection. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. What he's talking about here is this next movement and moment in human history. You may not know this, but this is the book that God wrote, and it's the only perfect thing on the earth. And when it was written, 25% of the scriptures were prophetic, meaning they were anticipating and they were declaring in advance the future. God knows the future. God rules the future. God controls the future. God reveals the future. And what it's talking about here is unveiling what awaits us. One of the things that has gripped the entire planet in the past few years with absolute anxiety and fear is uncertainty of the future, unknowing what is next. This hope that God gives his children through his word is that our God knows the future, rules the future, and reveals it to us to relieve the burden from us. And what it says here is that the day is coming when people will stop dying. Many will be in the ground, and many will still be walking on the planet. And there will be a day, we know not what day, it could be any day, that the Lord Jesus will return. Not only did the Lord Jesus die, and he was crucified, He was put to death by the Roman government, and he was executed openly and publicly, shamefully and painfully. He was then buried, and 3 days later, he physically rose from death. It's one of the greatest evidenced events in the history of the world. He appeared to crowds, upwards of 500, over the course of 40 days. This was an open public fact testified by those who write the scripture and historians who are not even Christians. And then Jesus returned into heaven. And so what we're waiting for now is this final great moment of the second coming of Jesus Christ. If we've learned anything in the last few years, is that the problem is down here and the solution is not. The problem is down here and the solution is not. That we need the solution to come from heaven to earth. That we are the problem and that Jesus needs to return and be our solution. And here it says that there is a day coming when the Lord Jesus will return. And what it's saying is, for those of us who are alive, we will be with him. And those of us who are dead, they will rise as he rose. I'm telling you this, heaven is far more earthy than we tend to think. Sometimes when we think of heaven, we think of immaterial souls sitting on a cloud, plinking a harp, wings and diapers. And I don't know about you, that does not seem like a real objective eternal goal. That is not something that I am very passionate about. The storyline of the Bible is that in Genesis 1 and 2, God made the planet perfect, made us in his image and likeness perfect. He told us to create art and culture and to travel and to explore and to develop and to innovate. And then we sinned and ruined and wrecked everything. But when Jesus returns, he goes back to God's original divine design plan. God's plan was good, and God does not deviate from his perfect plan. When we resurrect from the dead, we return to the plan that God originally had in Genesis 1 and 2. The result is that we will have physical bodies, that heaven and earth will come together, that the curse will be lifted, the world that we long for will come, the hope that we're aspiring for will be realized. This is the hope. We grieve, but we don't grieve as those who don't have this hope. For we declare this to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive are not left until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven. I can't wait to see that. I can't wait to see the Lord Jesus descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. That's Frank. Frank is going to rise from the dead, just as assuredly as Jesus Christ rose from the dead. Sometimes someone will die and people say, well, I hope they went to a better place. No, we know that he's gone to a better place, and we know that one day he will rise from the dead because he trusted in the Lord Jesus, and the Lord Jesus is always faithful to his promises. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, so we will always be with the Lord. And then he closes with this, therefore, encourage one another with these words. What he's saying is grieve with hope and encourage one another. And encourage literally means to pour courage into someone. And when we're looking at the future, sometimes we lack courage. When we anticipate death, we lack courage. When we're looking at losing someone we love or we're looking at losing our own life, it can discourage us. It can cause anxiety and fear. What it says is encourage one another. That is pour courage into one another. You pour courage into one another by not looking to the future, but looking up to the one who rules over it. You encourage one another not by looking at the grave, but by looking through it to the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the resurrection guarantee that he gives to his children. It's a great honor to speak with you today. But let me just close by giving you a simple analogy. For those of us who know the Lord and believe the word of God that reveals the future, we experience loss and grief and mourning and uncertainty differently because we know the one who rules and reigns over all eternity. Think of it in this way. I like to use this analogy. At the house, I'll watch the news, and then I'll flip over to the History Channel. And both are reporting events on Earth. The news, quite frankly, gives me a bit of anxiety because I'm not exactly sure what's going to happen. Things are still in process and undetermined. When I turn on the History Channel, I'm not nearly as anxious because it's from the 40s, 50s, and 60s, and I know how it ends. Here's what I'm telling you. If you believe the Bible and you know the Lord Jesus Christ, all of your life is the History Channel, not the nightly news. You know how it ends. And so you process the information differently. I was recently at home watching the History Channel, and I saw that Germany was invading Poland, and I didn't have a panic attack, because I know how that ended. Here's what I'm telling you. Jesus Christ conquers sin. Jesus Christ conquers death. Jesus Christ rules and reigns. Jesus Christ is Lord, King, God, Savior, and the only hope for all of humanity. Jesus Christ is coming again. Jesus is coming again to raise the dead. Jesus is coming again to lift the curse. Jesus is coming again to restore our planet and life on it. And in that resurrection body, I was thinking about it. Let's just have a little conversation. Do you think that in his resurrection body, on that great, glorious, grand, and good day, that Frank will be singing with the quartet? Yes. And you boys are going to sound great. You're going to sound great. He will get to do the things that God made him to do and he enjoyed doing in his physical body with the people that he loved. Will he get to go on dates with Barbara? Yes. They'll hold hands and they'll be friends. Now, there is a debate as to whether or not we're married. My wife and I disagree, so I won't comment on that. But pray for us that we will be married in heaven. Nonetheless, they will have a perfect friendship and a perfect relationship forever. This is not saying goodbye. This is saying I will see you again when we have a perfect relationship. Will Frank get to golf? Yes or no? Yes. In your resurrection body, you can golf, and he will be a very good golfer. Frank liked to eat out. That's what I was told. Will Frank get to go eat meals with his friends and family, kids and grandkids? Yes or no? Yes. Because God will return to his original divine design plan of Genesis. Will he get to fish? Yes. If he wants to print some things, can he print them? Yes, he can. If he wants to innovate and invent, will he be able to? Yes, because that's what we were made for. And once Jesus returns and the curse is lifted and God's people are restored, they will return to the things they were created for. Will he get to enjoy family and friends? Yes. See, today is a sad day, but there is a party that is planned in the kingdom of God. And when Jesus talks about heaven and the kingdom, usually it's tied to parties. His first miracle was at a wedding. And it says it was the first of his signs pointing to his kingdom. The reason that Jesus keeps talking about the kingdom of God and revealing the kingdom of God in parties and events is because heaven is a great homecoming. It's a party. It's where the family of God comes together. It's where the food is good and the people are joyful and the band is awesome and everyone is blessed. I would like to invite you to that party. And to receive that invitation is by receiving the invitation of Jesus Christ as your Lord and your God and your Savior. We grieve, and I want you to grieve, and I encourage you to grieve, but we don't grieve as those who don't have hope. He's having a great day, and we're going to see him again. You're going to hear his laugh. You're going to relive the great stories of life, and then you're going to plan the eternal adventures that never end. It's an honor to share with you. If you don't know the Lord Jesus, you need the Lord Jesus. And if you'd like to learn more about God's Word, the family has study Bibles for gifts in the foyer on the desk. They're very nice study Bibles. The questions will help answer whatever curiosities you may have. And we just give that as a gift to you. Here's what I know about Frank. He grew up in a home where the Word of God was preached and believed. And then he grew up to believe and teach the Word of God. And he passed that great certainty in the Word of God to his family. And the legacy of this family is really built on the truthfulness of God's Word, amen? And so they would like to make sure that before you leave, if you don't have a good Bible, they would love to have you leave here with a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and a Bible in your hand so that you can have hope for yourself and your future and your family. I love you. Barbara, it's an honor to be with you. We sure love you guys. And I'm just going to go ahead and pray. Father God, thank you for an opportunity. God, thank you that in moments like this, we don't have to get up and say, I hope, I think, I pray, I sure wish. We can say, thus saith the Lord. Our God has spoken about this. He is the resurrection and the life. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the Son of God. He is the creator, sustainer, and redeemer. And his name is Jesus Christ. Jesus, thank you. Thank you that you saved Frank. And thank you that he's having a great day. And even though he is missed, we look forward to seeing him again and the party and the reunion and the celebration that never ends. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, as you know, Frank loved to use the gift of music to connect one-on-one with his King, with his Creator. He used it all the time as a way to worship, to stand in awe, and to remember by singing familiar words, but also just letting the music resound in his heart and in his mind daily, which just made him feel closer and united with his Savior and even with his friends. And so he wanted for us to make sure that as a part of this celebration that we would just worship for a moment. So we're going to stand together. We're just going to close this time with a couple songs. Songs that declare truths about our God, our Creator, but also a way for us to connect with one another. Because when we sing together, it unites us in a supernatural way that none of us can even explain. So as you lift your voices, encourage each other with these psalms and hymns and spiritual songs.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship his holy name.
The sun comes up.
Sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass, whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Here we go, sing.
So bless the Lord.
Oh,
Lift your voices. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Father, we thank you for your love for us, your grace that is so undeserved. Father, you are great and greatly to be praised. Lord, I pray that as we go out into the community now, that people would see your brilliance in our lives and in our eyes. Lord, I pray that they'd see something different in us than what they see in the rest of the world. Because you are our great God. Lord, we thank you for the Woods family and just the incredible impact on all of our lives. Lord, I pray that you would be with them. Just in this season, this tough season, I pray that you'd comfort them, give them your peace. For all of us, Lord, that we would stand firm in a broken world, that we would be steadfast in your word as we go. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Have a great afternoon.